Hey, how's it going everyone? I'm Mike Pointer, and in my past few videos, I've explored the graphical capabilities and various tricks that were used for older consoles like the Super Nintendo and the Sega Mega Drive. At various times, I've used terms like scanlines, tiles, HDMI and others, and assumed my audience would know what I was talking about. But what if they didn't? I thought, maybe I should actually do a video that explains what these terms mean, in simple enough language for anyone to understand. So, if you've been wondering about this, then this video is for you. Alright, so let's start with scanlines, because it's the most logical place, and we need to understand them first or the rest of this won't make any sense. I guess a lot of you might only be aware of them due to how some retro devices and emulators have a filter that lets you turn them on and off. But what exactly are they? To understand this and why they are important for retro consoles, I'll first need to quickly explain how old CRT TVs worked. They basically had an electron beam that fired at the inside of the screen and quickly swept across and down the screen. One movement from the top left to the bottom right constituted one frame, so we're talking about this happening in a fraction of a second. To be precise, it would do this 60 times in 1 second for an NTSC TV that ran at 60 Hz, or 50 times in 1 second if you're talking about a PAL TV that ran at 50 Hz. This movement pattern of the beam is called a raster. A scanline is one sweep of this electron beam from one side of the screen to the other, and it was exactly 1 pixel high. Classic consoles like the Super Nintendo and Mega Drive had a native vertical resolution of 224 pixels. So when you're talking about that, what it actually technically is 224 scanlines. The filters I mentioned earlier that you can apply in some retro devices and emulators aren't showing the scan lines themselves, but rather the gaps between them. These gaps could vary in size depending on the size of the TV. Interlacing could fill in these gaps by alternating between the odd and even lines each frame, but while the 16-bit generation could do this to some extent, it didn't really become commonplace until the 5th generation. The electron beam would always move left to right from the viewer's point of view. It didn't alternate between left to right and then go back right to left. So the beam would need to stop firing when it reached the edge of the screen, move to the other side and down a bit, and then begin firing again to start the next scan line. When it finished the final scan line on the screen and it hit the bottom right corner, it would stop firing while it moved back up to the top left before firing again to begin the next frame. This tiny fraction of a second where the beam shuts off to move to the next position and fires again is called the blanking period, with the time between each scan line being the horizontal blank or H blank, and the time between each frame being the vertical blank or V blank. Because the beam needs to move further during V blank, this period is longer than the H blank period, but we're still only talking about minute fractions of a second here. If we slow a game right down, and I mean right down, we can demonstrate how the picture updates as the scan line moves down the screen. Remember, this is usually happening in less than the blink of an eye. It's completing a lap of the screen from the top to the bottom in 1/60th of a second for NTSC or 1/50th of a second for PAL. Developers couldn't really do any fancy tricks during VBlank because the frame had already finished drawing. So they usually use this time to copy data quickly from one place to another, using what was called DMA, or Direct Memory Access. The most common application of this was to copy graphics data from the RAM or cartridge ROM to VRAM directly, rather than getting the CPU to do it, resulting in a faster transfer and allowing more data to be copied in that brief period of time. However, programmers could perform various tricks during HBlank, because the frame had not finished drawing. They could use this fraction of a second while the beam moved from the end of one scan line to the start of the next to interrupt the screen drawing mid-frame and change what was in the video memory. This is what gave them the ability to pull off the raster effects I talked about in my Mega Drive video, allowing them to perform tricks like swapping the color palette or other data like sprite attribute tables halfway down the screen. I mentioned in my Mega Drive video that I believed the TurboGrafx-16 was the first console to feature a built-in scanline counter, which allowed developers to split the background layer or layers into smaller segments on specified scanlines, which could then be scrolled at varying speeds and in different directions, allowing for some nice parallax effects. Turns out, I was wrong about that. The humble Sega Master System actually had one as well. Heh, the more you know. Older consoles like the original Nintendo Entertainment System couldn't really do this without the use of enhancement chips though, but by the time the 16-bit generation came along, they could all do it. Regardless, this is another application of manipulating what's drawn to the screen during HBlank. This kind of thing was used pretty extensively on the Mega Drive, but not so much on the Super Nintendo. Not because it couldn't do it, because it absolutely could, but because it had other toys for programmers to play with, such as built-in transparency effects which I've covered previously, which removed the need for it in many cases. However, one common trick it was used for on the SNES was to split the screen on a specified scan line and show a different background mode in each segment. For example, this is what allowed it to show a Mode 7 world map or racing track in the bottom portion of the screen, while showing an independently scrolling multi-layer background like Mode 1 or Mode 2 in the top portion. It didn't even need to necessarily display different modes in each portion either. It could display the same mode if developers really wanted it to, like if they wanted to show two different independently scrolling or rotating Mode 7 backgrounds simultaneously. These mode splits were often disguised quite well with clever use of sprites. The screen could even be split multiple times, showing different modes in each segment, which is what's going on with some split-screen multiplayer games. The Super Nintendo had another trick up its sleeve that it could do during HBlank, and that was HDMA, or HBlank Direct Memory Access. It was a feature that was designed into the console's hardware, and allowed it to perform the direct memory access I spoke about earlier in smaller chunks during HBlank. It was often used to create color gradients, and if you look closely at some games, you'll see they have small parts of the screen or even individual scan lines a slightly different color. HDMA could be used in other ways, such as to create cool rolling-like scrolling effects by leaving gaps between scan lines that gradually got smaller and smaller, an effect which is sometimes mistaken for Mode 7. But speaking of Mode 7, these HDMA tricks could even be combined with it to achieve results that Mode 7 couldn't do on its own, such as bending and shift of perspectives. Other consoles like the Mega Drive could do something similar to this, such as swapping what was in the vertical scroll RAM or VS RAM to achieve vertical compression or stretching. This all happened during HBlank as well, and it could create some pretty cool looking graphical effects. But the Super Nintendo provided hardware that made it much easier. On the subject of the Mega Drive though, this will be a good time to quickly talk about blast processing. Yep, that old marketing babble. Except it was actually a real thing. Sort of. The term blast processing came from former Sega senior producer Scott Bayless, who mentioned to the PR guys that they could blast data into the DACs, or digital to analog converters. What he was actually talking about though was an implementation of DMA and raster effects that I covered in my previous video on the subject. In this case, it was used to essentially change the color palette on every scan line, effectively allowing the Mega Drive to go beyond its usual limitation of 64 colors on screen to display 256 color static images. That's an oversimplification of it, but if you're interested in learning more, I'll leave links in the description. However, I believe this was never actually used in any commercial game, due to it requiring precise timing that didn't work reliably on all iterations of the hardware or even across different TVs. However, homebrew developers in the years since have managed to get it working in some various demos. So yeah, blast processing was actually a real thing, just not what Sega's marketing would have had you believe back then. The last thing I wanted to cover in this video are tiles. All of these 3rd and 4th generation 2D consoles, 2D handhelds, and even a lot of the 2D arcade hardware at the time, constructed all of their graphics out of what were called tiles. On consoles like the Mega Drive, Super Nintendo, and TurboGrafx-16, a tile was usually 8x8 pixels in size. As we learned earlier, one scan line is 1 pixel high, so one tile is 8 scan lines high. But why did they use this approach, you might be asking? Well, that's a good question. Memory was surprisingly limited on these consoles. In fact, you may look at the memory specifications and wonder how the heck they worked at all, even when you consider we are talking about technology that was made circa 1990. Here's a quick overview of what each console had at the time. The consoles were tile-based to get around this limitation. If you split the image up into these smaller tiles, you'll notice that there's a lot of tiles that are the same. So you don't need to store all of these individual tiles in memory, you just need to store it once and draw it to the screen multiple times. Each of these consoles could store a set of tiles called a name table for each of their background layers plus a sprite layer. The graphics were constructed by selecting which tiles to draw to the screen, then selecting a color palette for each of those tiles. Each of these consoles had a limit to how many sprite tiles they could draw on screen at once, listed here, and sprites could be varying sizes, with larger sprites constructed of multiple tiles. However, they couldn't just shove all of these sprites into a small area. So just to bring this video around full circle to finish it off, the last thing I'll mention is that there was a maximum number of sprites they could display per scan line. If you tried to display more than that, that's when that infamous sprite flicker happened, as it would draw some sprites on even frames and some on odd frames, as the console was basically fighting with itself to attempt to display too many sprites. This happened quite a lot in the third generation, but was thankfully pretty rare during the fourth generation, though still happened from time to time. So that's all the stuff I wanted to cover in this video. Hopefully that gives you a good overview of what these terms mean, and you've gained a bit more of an insight into how these older consoles worked. These types of videos take a long time to put together, so I'd appreciate it if you give me a thumbs up if you liked it. It really helps a lot. Leave a comment below to start a discussion if you like, and don't forget to subscribe to stay up to date with my content. Thanks for watching, and see you next time!